Horvat breaking in. Deeks score.
Right there alone. And he stopped by Zelko.
Score. Brock Besser.
Canucks are back in action tomorrow. Wells Fargo Center. The 8-8-4 Philadelphia Flyers, minus the services of Radko Gudas. Gudas might not be around the next time the Canucks play the Flyers. It's a lengthy suspension. 10 games, in case you missed it. Over $400,000 in fine money for an ugly slash to the neck of Jets forward Matthew Perreault. So the 9-8-3 Vancouver Canucks in Philadelphia tomorrow. And they're also in Philadelphia right now. They'll be practicing in about 15 minutes' time. There to watch it, our next guest of the province, joining us every Monday, as he does, Ben Kuzma. Hello, Kuz. How you doing?
Good morning, gents. The 1923 University of Pennsylvania rink that coincides with my graduating year, so happy to be here.
Oh, Kuz.
Happy to be here. You know, the Dale Weiss watch is off because looks like we've got some news today with Anton Rodin and Philip Holm and all things Canucks, so lots to talk about.
Okay, well, let's start with Rodin, because we actually got news of that as we were going to air this morning, right at 9 o'clock. And basically, the experiment is over. The Canucks have placed him on unconditional waivers with the ultimate goal of terminating his contract. I guess, what are your thoughts of how this whole thing played out? Because Jason and I were kicking it around, and we said, you can't really blame anyone, per se, but it's still a disappointing result, because, you know, 2 years later, we still really have no idea what Anton Rodin could have done at the NHL level.
No, you're absolutely right that the infamous skate laceration at practice a couple of years ago and all the subsequent things that happened after that, the incredibly long rehab, finding out that the actual knee itself had never actually, the bone had actually never grown properly. I remember doing pieces on Rodin with some of the medical people associated with the Canucks, and they're talking about how they inherited a problem when he tried to come back to the Canucks. And you're absolutely right. I mean, the Canucks didn't have to take a one-year gamble on him and sign him at $700,000 just to see if he could play at this level. I think deep down, you kind of feel for the guy who only played, what, three actual NHL regular season games? You know, he's 26 years old. Could he go back home and play? Possibly. But I think, you know, at the end of it all, you kind of feel for the guy.
And then let's talk about the Philip Holm call-up, because there's a lot of different moving pieces on defense right now. Tanev and Stetcher are on this trip. Holm's up, Weirkotch is down. The other thing Jason and I were kicking around this morning is, when do you expect, or are you getting any sense from being traveling with the team, when Tanev and or Stetcher will draw back into the lineup?
Well, the funny thing about watching Tanev in practice, he looks like he's playing shuffleboard because with that thumb, he can't really shoot the puck. Mind you, and he's got two goals, of course, and we know that. But the funny thing is with Chris Tanev, how well he skates and how well he transitions the puck out of his own zone, he doesn't necessarily need to shoot the puck, but I think there's certainly a challenge there with that thumb. I think he's obviously closer than Stetcher, who's only started to skate. The Weirkotch thing, I think the Weirkotch thing is to get a look at Philip Holm, because quite frankly, when we saw Philip Holm in the preseason, we saw a guy who had tremendous trouble transitioning to the North American ice surface. He looked like he couldn't play the game at this level in terms of the ice surface in North America, but he's had a good start in Utica, and I think they're anxious to get a look at him. So I don't know. I think we'll see Tanev at some point on this trip. I don't know if it's going to be as soon as tomorrow night here in Philly or the next night in Pittsburgh, but on a six-game trip, I'm sure we'll see him. Stetcher's farther away, and maybe at some point, depending how those two things play out, we could see Holm at some point.
Kuz, this is more big-picture stuff, but we were talking about Alex Edler earlier in the show. He had a couple good games down in California paired with Derek Pouliot, but he had a nightmare of a game against Vegas, a few more mistakes against St. Louis, I'd say. Where is this guy's game at right now? And big picture, where do you see his future in Vancouver? Or do you see it?
Yeah, it's, what is he? 31 now, right?
He's 31. He's got 1 year left after this on his contract. He's got a full no trade.
Yeah, full no trade. I know. I've broached the subject with Alex Edler before. You know, he's maybe this is the problem. There's a comfort factor with Edler. He loves the city. He loves the fact there's Swedes on the team. He goes about his business. He's been hurt a lot. If you're ever able to have that conversation with Alex Edler and you're going in a certain direction on the back end, at least you hope you are, in a perfect world, you'd probably try to move him at the trade deadline, but he's not going to waive because, like I said earlier, I've always gotten the impression with Alex Edler that he's very comfortable in his own skin and he's very comfortable in the city and he doesn't want to go there. And I don't know, does that factor into his roller coaster existence in Vancouver? Maybe, to a degree. I mean, injuries haven't helped. And like you said, you'll see Alex Edler have a decent game and suddenly he's paired with Pouliot and they know what they're doing and then they have a game like the Vegas game. So I think, I don't want to use the word stuck with him, but I think it's going to just, the contract thing is just going to play itself out that at the end of it all, he's not going to waive and he's going to play out his contract here and the Canucks will have to go from then. He'll be a 32-year-old guy. And I think it's kind of confounding when I think of Alex Edler, you know, dial it back. Remember that LA series when he was just destroying everybody? His ability to play physical was there in the past. I don't think it's there anymore. I think he's more of a positional guy on the wall against guys. Probably like too many D-men stick checks too much. But, you know, at the end of the day, I think when his time is done here, it might be one of those situations where we look back and say, maybe what could have been.
Because this was another thing that we were kicking around earlier, and it was the notion of getting that old feeling again. And by that, I mean those feelings of last year. You look at the team through 20 games this year, 9-8-3 with 21 points. Last year, after 20 games, 8-10-2 with 18 points. So there's a nominal increase in wins and points. And I think for the large part, you can say, this isn't like last year. This is a better team. There's more youth. There's more excitement. But I can't help but feel with the injuries and the way things have gone over the last little bit, maybe it's because I'm scarred personally, but every now and again, I kind of get that, oh no, here we go again feeling. Have you got that at all?
Sorry, you are scarred.
Yeah.
Get that straight, okay?
Yeah, okay.
You are scarred.
That's fair.
But you know what? You're right. I mean, when you start to break it down, I mean, yeah, there's it's kind of like the Titanic. There's more chairs to move around the deck, okay? But every, you know, the band's playing and the ship is listing badly. Port, stern, whatever. So that's a problem. I mean, when you look at all the stats that count, the special teams, you know, 23rd on the power play now, 21 on the PK, you know, only 25th in what, goals per game, and they're decent in not giving up as many. But the problem is, what have the Canucks become? Yet again, a one-line hockey club. Mind you, younger one-line hockey club with some movable pieces around them. So, yeah, it's fair to say, geez, are we going down that road again here? I mean, the Canucks will tell you they have better depth and they have some kids coming along. They do. I mean, we love Besser. Jake can play. Okay, let's get that straight. But the bottom line is, when you look at the free agent acquisitions, we knew what we were getting in Vanek. I mean, you take a one-year roll of the dice on him, a hired gun, Tommy Gunn. He's pretty good down low. He's better than I thought there. You look at the three-year commitment to Sam Gagne, which doesn't look very good right now. They were hoping for more from Delzato. So, yeah, it's fair to say I've seen this movie before.
Kuz, thanks a lot for joining us today. Always appreciate it. Enjoy practice and enjoy the game tomorrow. And we will talk next Monday when you'll be in New York.
Absolutely, boys. Take care.
Thanks.
Thanks, Kuz.
Ben Kuzma of The Province.